Hello, I am Harsh Marathe from SET GS Medical College and KEM Hospital. I am going to discuss renal handling of sodium and diuretics in this video. Learning objectives for this session are to understand significance of maintaining sodium balance, to understand sodium handling by nephron, which will include first having a big picture in the mind, then understanding cellular mechanisms, and we will also see hormonal influence whenever the point will come in the discussion. To get introduced to diuretics and their actions is another of our learning objectives. Why is renal handling of sodium so much important? Well, kidney basically maintains sodium balance, and in fact theme of renal physiology revolves around this term balance, which literally means matching of intake of something with its output. So when sodium intake is equal to sodium output, sodium balance is maintained. What if sodium intake exceeds sodium output? Then the body content of sodium will increase, which will increase ECF volume, which will increase blood pressure and can cause edema. A decrease in sodium content, which can occur due to excessive output of sodium, also causes ECF volume contracture. So, as sodium is not only the major cation but also the major osmole of the extracellular fluid, maintaining sodium balance is very pretty much important function of the kidney. First things first, let us look at filtration. Sodium is filtered freely across the glomerular capillaries. The significance of this free filtration is that the sodium concentration of ultrafiltrate form is same as that of sodium concentration of plasma, and therefore calculation of filtered load is simple. It is just multiplication of GFR with sodium concentration of plasma. What if sodium was not freely filtered? Then we would have to think about something called as sieving coefficient. But as sodium is freely filtered, sieving coefficient is literally 1. What if a cation is bound to plasma proteins? Which is not the case for sodium, but I highly encourage you to read about calcium balance and see how the filtered load is calculated. We will have to take an unbound fraction here. So, what is the filtered load? 180 liters of ultrafiltrate is formed in each day, and each liter of that 180 liters is going to have 140 milliequivalents of sodium, because 140 milliequivalents is the sodium concentration in the ECF. So the filtered load is simply the product, which is 25,200 milliequivalents per day. What is average sodium intake? It's about 150 milliequivalents. So in order to maintain balance, kidneys will have to excrete less than 1% of the filtered load. More importantly, 99.4% of filtered load has to be absorbed, and this reabsorption is the pretty much thing that we are going to study now. But I want to consider this one point: the very large value of GFR that we see, which comes in calculation of the filtered load, has its own implications. If GFR is increased just by 1%, then the urine output, then the ultrafiltrate form will be increased by about 20 liters itself, which puts a very large load on the tubules to work and reabsorb. So whenever GFR changes, consequent changes in the reabsorption are also needed. And how are those going to happen? That is also a point of discussion that we will encounter when we will look at glomerulotubular balance. So let's have a big picture of sodium balance. 67% of the sodium filtered is reabsorbed in the proximal tubule itself. The characteristic, or the one word that you should remember about reabsorption in the proximal tubule, is that it is isoosmotic. 25% of the filtered load is absorbed in thick ascending limb, and thick ascending limb is the diluting segment. 5% of the sodium load is absorbed in early DCT, and this is the segment which is thiazide sensitive. Late DCT and collecting ducts absorb only 3% of the sodium, but it is the site where fine tuning of sodium balance is going to occur. No wonder it is the साइट ऑफ एक्शन ऑफ हार्मोन अल्डोस्टेरॉन. दिस इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू इज द रोड मैप ऑफ अवर डिस्कशन. विल बी गोइंग थ्रू ईच एंड एवरी सेक्शन और ईच एंड एवरी सेगमेंट ऑफ दिस नेफ्रॉन एंड डिस्कसिंग इन डिटेल व्हाट हैपन्स एट ईच स्टेज. सो विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद प्रॉक्सिमल टिब्यूल, देन वी विल लुक सब्सिक्वेंटली ईच सेगमेंट वन बाय वन. सो लेट स्टार्ट. Proximal tubule is the site where bulk absorption of sodium and water takes place. It is the site of glomerulotubular balance. And work of proximal tubule can be studied by performing TFYP analysis. What is this? TFYP analysis is basically a graph in which you are plotting proximal tubule length on x-axis and on y-axis you are going to plot TFYP ratio. What is TFYP ratio? TFYP ratio is nothing but ratio of a particular substance concentration in the tubular fluid with respect to its concentration in the plasma. So, what about sodium? How will the TFYP analysis of sodium look like? First of all, at the starting point where proximal tubule starts, what will be the concentration of sodium? It will be about 140 milliequivalents per liter, which is the same as that in the plasma. So, we'll start with 1. As we will go along the proximal tubule, sodium will be reabsorbed. But understand that water also will be reabsorbed along with sodium. And the way proximal tubule works is that if it absorbs 50% of the water, it is also absorbing 50% of the sodium, which is actually going to keep the concentration of sodium constant throughout the length of proximal tubule, which literally means that TFYP ratio is also not going to change as we go along the proximal tubule. This is true for sodium, which is one of the major solutes, and this is also true for total solutes, and that's what we mean when we say that the proximal tubule absorbs isosmotically. If 50% of solutes are absorbed, then 50% of water is also taken out from the tubular fluid. Nice. Now, I want you to think about what will happen with inulin. Inulin, remember, it is that substance which is freely filtered but neither secreted nor reabsorbed. We use it for measuring GFR. Yes. So, if it is not reabsorbed, neither secreted, the concentration of inulin will go on increasing as we will be moving along this proximal tubule. Why is that so? Because even if inulin content is constant, water content is decreasing, which is going to increase its concentration, and therefore concentration inside the tubular fluid will go on rising, which will create a graph like this. And as 2/3 of the fluid is reabsorbed by the time we reach the end of proximal tubule, the inulin concentration will actually become 3 times by the time we reach end of the proximal tubule. Okay, so basically for sodium concentration is remaining constant, and for inulin content is remaining constant. This is the concept that I wanted to discuss here. Another point that I want to tell you is that what happens with glucose. So, I'll just change the color here. So, glucose is reabsorbed extensively in the early proximal tubule itself, and its reabsorption is more in proportion with respect to that of water. And therefore, the tubular fluid by plasma ratio will go on decreasing. As you are removing more and more glucose from tubular fluid, concentration in the tubular fluid will decrease and that in the plasma will increase, thus decreasing the ratio. In fact, in the early proximal tubule itself, 99% or most of the filtered load of glucose is absorbed by a cotransporter called as sodium glucose cotransporter 2, SGLT2. So the graph will be kind of like this. So this is true for glucose and amino acids. There, most of the reabsorption of glucose and amino acids is completed in the early proximal tubule itself. So that was about glucose. The straight line was for sodium, the flat line, and this line is for the inulin. Now what happens with bicarbonate? Bicarbonate is also reabsorbed in the early proximal tubule, and therefore Its concentration also goes on dropping just like glucose, but the drop is not that significant in the early proximal tubule itself. So the graph is kind of like this. So now we can proceed, and before going ahead, I want to add one thing in your mind. What will happen with chloride? Chloride is not really reabsorbed in the early segments. If it is not reabsorbed, then its concentration will go on increasing just like inulin. So it will follow inulin in the early proximal tubule. But later on, the chief solute that will be reabsorbed will be sodium chloride. And therefore, the graph will take a turn. So the graph is going to go like this and then flat. So there, that's the graph for chloride. Now that we have discussed this, we can go and see what happens at cellular level inside the proximal tubule. So this is the orientation slide for you, so that you won't get confused. Many of our slides will be having the same pattern, and I want you to become familiar with this pump, which is drawn on the right side of the figure, which is separating which is the basolateral membrane of the cell. So this pump is nothing but the other familiar sodium potassium ATPase, which pumps sodium out from the intracellular fluid into the interstitium. The power of this pump is tremendous, and this fact is of particular importance because therefore the sodium reabsorption process cannot be saturated in the normal filtered loads of the sodium, and therefore sodium actually follows gradient time transport characteristics. What do we mean by that? Gradient refers to the sodium gradient created. If sodium concentration in the lumen is more, then the sodium reabsorption will increase proportionately. Similarly, when time that fluid remains in the lumen is more, then the pump will get more chance to put that sodium in the interstitium, and sodium reabsorption will increase proportionately. This is in contrast, basically this is another type of reabsorption compared to that of reabsorption having transport maximum, like glucose. Glucose has a transport maximum, which literally means that when the sodium concentration reaches a limit inside the lumen, then it cannot be further put back into the tubule. The excess glucose then comes in the urine, and we have glucosuria. But for sodium, the reabsorption particularly follows gradient time characteristics. What can put a limit on sodium reabsorption? It is the backleak of sodium that can happen via leaky tight junctions present in proximal tubule. Remember that in proximal tubule, the tight junction presents are leaky, whereas in the distal convoluted tubule, the tight junctions present are tight junctions, and therefore they won't allow such backleak. But in proximal tubule, such backleak is allowed, and this can put a limit on how much of the sodium or rate at which sodium is getting reabsorbed. This here shows a particular representation of carrier that we will be following, and this here shows a representation of channel. On the left side of each slide, we will be looking at lumen, and on the right side, there will be interstitial fluid and then subsequently blood. So, let's start. In the early proximal tubule, don't get scared looking at that diagram. In the early proximal tubule, on the luminal membrane, we have a lot of symporters, which will be basically ferrying something along with downhill movement of sodium. That something can be glucose or amino acids or phosphate and lactate or citrate, anything. The energy for the uphill movement of glucose or uphill movement of amino acids is actually derived from downhill movement of sodium. This is because sodium deficiency is created by this pump, which we know as sodium potassium ATPase. So this actually works in a manner which we call a secondary active transport. Now the glucose and amino acids or phosphate or lactate or citrate which entered the cell, they leave the cell via facilitated diffusion on the basolateral side. A point that I would like to add here is that this sodium phosphate symporter present here is actually inhibited by parathormone. And while studying calcium balance, we will also learn that parathormone PTH is nothing but phosphate terminating hormone, because it is going to increase the excretion of phosphates by inhibiting sodium phosphate cotransporter. Now we will have a look at this exchanger present here. Remember that secondary active transport can be carried out by cotransporters as well as exchangers. And this sodium hydrogen exchanger is of particular interest because it is responsible for bicarbonate reabsorption in the proximal tubule. And we have learned that in the early proximal tubule, the solute reabsorbed is sodium bicarbonate, while in the late proximal tubule, the solute that will be reabsorbed will be sodium chloride. So now let's have a look at it. Before proceeding, I will like to add this point here. As you are transporting sodium and glucose, remember that SGLT2 takes almost all the glucose load in the early proximal tubule itself. The transport is actually generating negative charge inside the lumen, as you are putting positively charged sodium ions from the lumen inside the cell. So you will develop lumen negative electric potential, which is of particular significance when we go to late proximal tubule. Before we do that, we want to have a look at the sodium hydrogen exchanger and its work and the mechanism of reabsorption of bicarbonate. So here it is. The way I like to remember mechanism of reabsorption of bicarbonate is that it is a geared connection like this. And what do I mean by geared connection? This one rotating wheel, which is going to rotate a second wheel. So what is the first rotating wheel here? The first rotating wheel here is the sodium potassium ATPase that we are familiar with, this thing. And it is putting sodium out continuously from the intracellular space, generating sodium deficiency here, which will generate a pull on sodium and fetch the sodium inside via sodium hydrogen exchanger. The exchanger puts one proton out from the intracellular space into the lumen for each ion of sodium that comes in. So what is going to happen is that bicarbonate, which comes in the filtered load, will be reabsorbed by the following process. The H plus which got secreted will combine with it and form CO2 and H2. Remember that this reaction, catalyzed by carbonic anhydrase type 4 present on the luminal membrane, is potentially reversible. But the way this is going in the particular direction is because this sodium hydrogen exchanger is constantly putting this proton inside the lumen. Then the CO2 and H2O can diffuse inside, where they will be acted upon by carbonic anhydrase type 2. And carbonic anhydrase type 2 actually is catalyzing the reaction again in the reverse direction now, because this H plus is being extruded from the intracellular space by sodium hydrogen exchanger. So after we have this idea, we can understand that this is kind of a wheel that is created to secrete H plus and reabsorb bicarbonate by doing so. But this wheel is actually working on the sodium, on the basis of sodium deficiency that is created by our first wheel, which is nothing but the sodium potassium ATPase. The important point here is that we have a diuretic that actually acts on carbonic anhydrase, this carbonic anhydrase type 4 as well as carbonic anhydrase type 2 present inside the cell, and that is going to block this so bicarbonate reabsorption process. And by doing so, it actually generates metabolic acidosis. Why? Because more of the filtered bicarbonate, which is base, is going in the lumen and then into the urine, which literally means that you are depleting extracellular fluid of the bicarbonate, which is generating metabolic acidosis. This carbonic anhydrase inhibitors is a class of drugs, in fact, and the prototype drug is acetazolamide. And acetazolamide has various uses and are remembered by the mnemonic. This is a famous mnemonic called as GAME. G stands for glaucoma, telling the fact that they can be topically applied to reduce aqueous humor tension. A stands for acute mountain sickness. The metabolic acidosis generated by the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors is actually useful in keeping respiratory center kind of sensitive to the changes in CO2, which will help in acclimatization. So they are given prophylactically before you go to hilly areas or before you go to altitudes which are very high. It is also used in treating metabolic alkalosis and epilepsy. So carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, you can remember this mnemonic for its uses. GAME, the site of action will be RB proximal tibule, and the way it acts is by actually inhibiting this cycle that I have shown here. So that's about early proximal tibule. As we go to the late proximal tibule, the salt that is reabsorbed now is sodium chloride, and it has also got a paracellular route to go into interstitial fluid. In the early part, the chloride was not reabsorbed and it was left in the lumen. Therefore, its concentration went on increasing. Remember that in the early part, that tubular fluid by plasma concentration graph for chloride was following inulin, and then it got straight. This is the time, this is the place where it will become straight. And this is because of chloride format exchanger, which will be driving chloride inside the cell, and then chloride can diffuse outside via its channel. So that is the thing happening in the late proximal tubule. And as chloride gets reabsorbed, the potential of the lumen actually again increases to 4 millivolts. And this is not that important actually, but the lumen positive potential that we will see in thick ascending limb has a particular significance, and we will look at it in just a minute. Before we go to thick ascending limb, we will have to look at glomerulotubular balance. Remember, proximal tibule is the site of glomerulotubular balance also. What is glomerulotubular balance? Remember, we had talked about if there are perturbations in GFR, then the tubule will have to do more work. And the way that glomerulus is going to talk with proximal tibule is by means of glomerulotubular balance, or it is by the means of this term, which is PICE or oncotic pressure or colloid oncotic pressure of plasma. So the concept is basically plasma proteins which are present in the blood are not filtered across the glomerular filtration barrier, and therefore if filtration is increased, then all of the plasma proteins, the concentration of the plasma proteins in the plasma leaving the glomerulus will be increased. On the other hand, if there is a decrease in GFR, there will be decreased oncotic pressure of the fluid leaving glomerulus or the peritubular capillary blood, and this decreased oncotic pressure is going to decrease reabsorption. As you know, more the concentration of plasma proteins, the more the water that it will attract osmotically. So if it is less, then less reabsorption is going to happen. PICE is in fact one of the most important starling force that we will encounter in tubular reabsorption process. There is another point that I would like to tell you here, is that PICE actually creates a self-control system in case of volume expansion and volume contraction. So let's see what will happen if there is volume contraction or depletion of fluid volume. If there is depletion of fluid volume, that is when blood volume is decreased, concentration of plasma proteins is going to increase, which will increase PICE, which will actually attract water osmotically in the proximal tubule and therefore increase the reabsorption. Regarding what happens in volume contraction, there is one more mechanism which is actually important, which is basically when there is volume contraction, RAS will be activated, and we will have a look at what happens when the RAS is activated when we reach actually terminal nephron. But regarding the same thing, I have a question for you, and it is very much related to proximal tubule. So let's see that question. A decrease in blood volume activates RAS. Which of the following is or are the direct effect of angiotensinogen 2 on nephron independent of aldosterone? So, think about it. What is going to happen when there is decrease in blood volume? When there is decrease in blood volume, we will have to increase sodium reabsorption so that we would be able to increase ECF volume again back to the normal. And we saw that there is a self-controlling mechanism that decrease in the blood volume itself is increasing PyC and which can increase reabsorption of water. But another way is RAS, and I am asking you about the direct action of angiotensinogen 2. So it cannot be increase in sodium excretion or a decrease in sodium reabsorption. It has to be related to increase in sodium reabsorption. And if you read the two options, which have the increase in sodium reabsorption. First option tells us that increase in sodium reabsorption by inhibiting sodium hydrogen exchanger present in PCT. Will this work? If we inhibit sodium hydrogen exchanger, we are going to decrease sodium reabsorption. So our answer here is increase in sodium reabsorption by stimulation of NHE present in PCT. Now remember, this is the direct effect of angiotensinogen 2. Direct effect of angiotensinogen 2 is on the PCT, and the way that it acts is by stimulation of sodium hydrogen exchanger that we saw while looking at reabsorption of filtered bicarbonate. If this is clear, then we have to continue now and look at what happens in thick ascending limb. As the tubule will go to the thick ascending limb, there is not much change in the sodium concentration in the sodium content of the fluid. The next site of reabsorption of sodium is the thick ascending limb, and I want you to remember that this is the place where dilution of fluid is going to occur. And how thick ascending limb is going to dilute the fluid? It is going to dilute it by pumping solutes out. In fact, the thick ascending limb, the wall of thick ascending limb is impermeable to water. It doesn't allow water to go out from it, and therefore water is kept inside the tube in the lumen itself. And when you go on pumping solutes out from such confined compartment, the fluid is going to become more and more dilute. Let's see exactly how this happens. So you have a sodium potassium 2 chloride. Consider this thing, there is a mistake in that diagram. You need to have 2 chlorides there. So there is sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter present on the lumen of thick ascending limb. And what this transporter is actually going to do is that it is going to catch the sodium chloride and potassium present in the lumen and then put it inside the intracellular fluid. And the driving force for this is again the sodium potassium pump creating sodium deficiency. What will happen to this chloride which comes inside? It can get diffused to the interstitial fluid via chloride channels, and we also have a sodium chloride co-transporter on the basolateral side. What happens to this potassium? Well, this is of particular interest because directly speaking, this pump is electroneutral, but working of this pump is generating lumen positive electric potential. And how is that possible? This is because of back diffusion or back leak of potassium that came inside the tubule. And that back leak generating lumen positive potential in thick ascending limb of loop of Henle is particularly important because that is going to create a driving force for paracellular transport of calcium and magnesium. And therefore, thick ascending limb is not only absorbing sodium and water and chloride and potassium, but also absorbing calcium and magnesium. And therefore, when you give loop diuretics like Lasix, which actually bind to the chloride binding site of sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter, what is going to happen is that this lumen positive potential cannot be formed. So the way I like to remember action of Lasix is that when you give loop diuretics, thick ascending limb cell says loops. I couldn't keep that sodium chloride potassium, I have lost it, and everything basically falls and goes in urine. So, we say that loops lose calcium. And now we can understand this is because they eliminate the lumen positive potential that is formed due to backleak of potassium, which happens because of the action of sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter. If this thing is clear, then now we can have a look at various uses of diuretics and their effects and side effects. So first of all, we'll look at effects and side effects. One of the effect is diuresis, which we know, that is why we are calling it diuretic. In fact, loops are most powerful diuretics that you are going to get. Hypokalemia and alkalosis, you can understand hypokalemia right here itself, but the way this occurs is actually happening in the terminal nephron. The mechanism for hypokalemia and alkalosis, will just keep that thing on the hold and we'll look at it when we reach terminal nephron. What you can understand is that hypocalcemia and hypomagnesemia occur because of loops. Because loops, when they act, we have already seen that loops lose calcium, and that is how they produce hypocalcemia and hypomagnesemia. Another side effect is hyperuricemia, and this is because loops compete with organic anion transporter present in the proximal tubule. Loops also create ototoxicity, which is not of particular interest right now, but you need to remember this thing, that they create ototoxicity. Another action of loops is that they generate acute pulmonary edema. Another use of the loops is that they are used in treatment of acute pulmonary edema. And why is that so? Because loops have also one secondary action, and it is important one, that they increase the systemic venous capacitance, and therefore they can be used in acute pulmonary edema, congestive heart failure. They can be used while treating hypertension and also while treating hypercalcemic states. As we have learned, that loops lose calcium, so they can be used when calcium levels have gone up. So that's the summary of loop diuretics, or that's the thing that you need to remember about loop diuretics. So we can now proceed to early DCT. Before going ahead, I just wanted to ask you this question. Do you know why the trade name of furosemide or furosemide is Lasix? If you know, then put your answer in the comment section. Early DCT. Early DCT is also going to dilute the urine, and this is where thiazide sensitive sodium chloride cotransporters are present. So there you have those thiazide sensitive sodium chloride cotransporters, and when you give thiazide diuretics like HCTZ, these cotransporters are inhibited, and which kind of creates sodium deficiency in here, and which actually stimulates this thing, which is putting calcium out from the intracellular space into the interstitial fluid, and therefore increasing calcium reabsorption. So in contrast with loop diuretics, which lose calcium, thiazides actually save calcium. In early DCT itself, we have TRPV5, which is upregulated by parathyroid hormone, and many times we, in reading calcium metabolism actually, many times we get confused which TRPV is where. Like there is TRPV6 and TRPV5. So TRPV6 is present in intestine and upregulated by vitamin D for calcium absorption, and TRPV5 is in kidney and it is upregulated by vitamin D or parathyroid hormone for calcium reabsorption. The way I remember which one is where is by just remembering that intestine is 6 meters long. So what you have in kidney is TRPV5. So if that is clear, we can see at the uses of thiazide diuretics. And thiazide diuretics can be used for treating congestive heart failure, hypertension and nephrolithiasis. Can you correlate why? Because nephrolithiasis are basically calcium stones formed in the lower urinary tract. So if you are increasing calcium reabsorption and inducing diuresis, they can be used in treating urinary stones basically. Another use of thiazide diuretics, which is of particular interest, is this: nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. And isn't it paradoxical that you are using diuretic in a condition called as diabetic insipidus? Remember what is diabetes insipidus? Diabetes insipidus is the condition wherein you have polydipsia and polyuria. Polydipsia, polyuria. You have to drink a lot of water and then you have to go and urinate a lot of times. So you are giving a diuretic to a patient having diabetes insipidus. Yes, it is paradoxical and we will have look at it in a minute. Before going further and looking at this diabetes insipidus thingy, I want you to have a look at side effects of using thiazide diuretics. And hypokalemia and alkalosis is going to occur by pretty much same mechanism as that of loops, and we are going to see that mechanism when we reach terminal nephron. Hyperuricemia is also going to occur by the same mechanism, that is by competition with organic anion transporter present in the proximal tubule. Thiazides also cause hyperglycemia and therefore they are contraindicated in patients with diabetes mellitus. So, diabetes insipidus is the condition wherein you have decreased action of arginine vasopressin or ADH either because of decreased secretion or because of uncoupled V2 receptors, or you can just think that there is resistance to the action of ADH. So there are two types, basically central and nephrogenic. The treatment of central diabetes insipidus is simple. You give AVP analog or ADH analog, which is desmoprosin. What I want you to remember is the treatment for nephrogenic diabetes insipidus is HCTZ or thiazide diuretics, and this is because the action will be happening by proximal tubule compensation. The sodium loss that thiazides are going to create will actually induce mechanisms which will try to increase the reuptake, which will actually feedback increase in the reuptake of sodium reabsorption, and that actually brings back water along with it also and decreases urine output. In fact, some people say that if you are a diabetic, diabetes insipidus patient and your urine output is about 11 liters per day, then by taking thiazide you can decrease it up to 3 liters per day also. So that is an important point that one should remember because it's paradoxical. Now we can continue with terminal nephron and understand that there are two types of cells present in the terminal nephron. Principal cells and intercalated cells. Principal cells are the ones which are responsible for sodium reabsorption, and water is going to follow sodium, and principal cells are also responsible for potassium secretion. In fact, these two things are coupled, and that is the reason we are going to see that particular side effect on administration of loop diuretics or thiazide diuretics. We also have intercalated cells, which are again divided into type A and type B. And the way I like to remember this thing is that type A is responsible for acid secretion and type B is responsible for bicarb secretion. Right now we are interested in looking at type A alpha or alpha intercalated cells only. They are also responsible for potassium reabsorption, which is going to increase when you give loop and thiazide diuretics, and that is what is going to induce hypokalemia along with alkalosis. So let us see what happens. Principal cells have ENaC transporters or epithelial sodium channels on the lumen, which will take sodium inside, and we have our friendly, nice, powerful sodium potassium ATPase, which is going to pump this sodium out from the lumen. It also carries two potassium ions inside the cell as it pumps three sodium out, and this is the reason why sodium reabsorption, water reabsorption, is coupled with potassium secretion in principal cells. So whenever you are giving loop diuretics or thiazide diuretics, sodium load that is reaching DCT or CD is actually increased, and when there is increased sodium load here, more of the sodium will be going inside, which will actually release potassium, and this potassium will be going inside via this route, via type A alpha intercalated cell. And when this potassium reabsorption increases, H plus is secreted, therefore we are going to have hypokalemia as more and more potassium is wasted, and alkalosis. So if this is clear, we can now focus on hormonal influences happening on principal cells themselves. So principal cells are actually under the control of aldosterone, and aldosterone is a steroid hormone which will be increasing the action of which will be upregulating ENaC transporters and sodium potassium ATPase and increasing sodium reabsorption. So when you give aldosterone antagonists like spironolactone, or when you give amiloride, which is basically ENaC channel inhibitor, these things are going to act as potassium sparing diuretics. And this is an important thing, because all other diuretics that we saw, like loop diuretics or thiazide diuretics, they were causing hypokalemia. But potassium sparing diuretics are going to increase potassium reabsorption. And this is because they are decreasing potassium secretion, because they are basically hampering the mechanism of principal cells, which is basically potassium secretion, sodium reabsorption, and water following sodium. The use of potassium sparing diuretics like spironolactone, or even use of ENaC channel inhibitors like amiloride, is actually adjunct use, because when you give loops or thiazides, the hypokalemia that they are going to cause can be actually prevented, and diuretic action can be increased by giving these things. Now, this aldosterone is actually a part of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, and therefore, I'm going to ask you a second question based on the RAS system itself. Which of the following correctly describes effect of 81 receptor blocker? What is 81 receptor? 81 receptor is receptor for angiotensin 2. And when you give angiotensin 2 receptor blocker, effects of angiotensin will be gone. So what is effect of angiotensin? Angiotensin increases aldosterone levels. We all know that RAS, renin angiotensin aldosterone system. So plasma levels of aldosterone are now going to go down, which is happening in the first option itself. So what is going to happen with sodium excretion? Sodium excretion will be increased. Why? Because RAS is not working, and RAS is helping in sodium reabsorption, is helping in putting sodium and water back inside the lumen. So if it is not working, then sodium excretion will increase. What will happen with total peripheral resistance? Total peripheral resistance is actually determined by level of constriction of arterioles inside the body, and angiotensin 2 actually constricts arterioles by acting on the same 81 receptors. It acts on the same receptors to increase aldosterone level at adrenals. And it acts by the same receptors in the vasculature to increase the vascular tone. And as this is not happening, vascular tone will decrease. And what about arterial pressure? Arterial pressure is going to fall. And this is because increased sodium excretion which will decrease sodium content and therefore decrease BP. So the answer to this question is option A. So now we can proceed and self-check ourselves. After listening to all the talk that I did, could you understand that the significance of maintaining sodium balance is that sodium content determines ECF volume, which in turn determines BP, and therefore sodium balance is pretty much important. It is not only the major cation but also the major osmole. Then we had a look at tubular function. So let us summarize what all we had seen. In the early proximal tubule, highest priority work was done by various co-transporters, and sodium, glucose, amino acids, phosphate, etc. was absorbed. I also pointed out that parathyroid hormone has phosphate terminating action, or it is also called as phosphate terminating hormone, because it inhibits sodium phosphate co-transporter. Then we looked at NHE, which is sodium hydrogen exchanger, responsible for reabsorption of sodium bicarbonate, and its activity is induced by angiotensin 2, which is in fact the direct effect of angiotensin 2. Then we went to late proximal tubule where sodium chloride reabsorption occurs, where chloride gradient drives sodium reabsorption and paracellular route is also active. Then we went to thick ascending limb of loop of Henle, which actually dilutes the fluid. There is calcium and magnesium reabsorption by paracellular route, which is because of lumen positive potential created by sodium potassium 2 chloride pump pumping sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter taking chloride intracellularly and then back diffusion of potassium into the lumen. Hormonal influence here is that ADH, and you will read more about it while reading water balance. We can go to the next section, which is the early distal tubule. Early distal tubule is where dilution occurs by sodium chloride reabsorption, and sodium chloride cotransporter is actually responsible for this thing, which is thiazide sensitive. Parathyroid hormone also stimulates calcium reabsorption by, remember which, TRPV6 or TRPV5? Yes, TRPV5, upregulating TRPV5 channels. Terminal nephron is what we saw at the last, and it is the aldosterone dependent and responsible for fine tuning of sodium balance. After understanding this much, we can surely put a tick mark that we have understood the sodium handling by nephron, at least at basic level. Did we get introduced to diuretics? Let's see the summary. We learned that in proximal tubule, carbonic anhydrase is inhibited by drugs like acetazolamide, which indirectly inhibits sodium bicarbonate reabsorption in proximal tubule. They can be used, remember the mnemonic GAME, for glaucoma, acute mountain sickness, metabolic acidosis and epilepsy. The comment that I have made here is that they induce metabolic acidosis, and this is particularly useful, and that is the reason why we give them for acute mountain sickness or for treating metabolic alkalosis. So loop diuretics are the next thing that we saw, and loop diuretics like furosemide, remember I have asked you one question about it, why the trade name of furosemide is Lasix, and if you know it, you are going to put a comment. I was talking about furosemide, which binds chloride binding site of sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter on the lumen of thick ascending limb, and it is the DOC for acute pulmonary edema and chronic congestive heart failure. And the reason we can give it for acute pulmonary edema, remember that thing, that it increases systemic venous capacitance. Then it can be given for hypertension and hyperkalemia. Remember that loops lose calcium. Hypokalemia and alkalosis are important side effects, and hyperuricemia is also an important side effect that you should remember. Thiazide diuretics like HCTZ inhibit sodium chloride cotransporter in early DCT. Congestive heart failure and hypertension or nephrolithiasis are the basic conditions that can be treated with thiazide diuretics. And one thing that I forgot to write here is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. And as this is a paradoxical thing, it is examiners like to go in such areas. Hypokalemia and alkalosis, hyperuricemia and hyperglycemia are notable side effects of giving thiazide diuretics. So after we see thiazide diuretics, we can then proceed to potassium sparing diuretics, which act on terminal nephron, like amiloride, which blocks inact channels of spironolactone, which is aldosterone antagonist, and they are weak diuretics on their own, but they are mainly given as an adjunct use with these two. This is one class of diuretics that we didn't talk about, and it is osmotic diuretics. Example of it would be mannitol. And what is the site of action of osmotic diuretics? It is all along the nephron. They act all along the nephron. And why is that so? The osmotic diuretics like mannitol, once they are filtered, they are not reabsorbed, and they keep water with them inside the lumen all along the tubule. And with water, sodium also remains inside the lumen, since it is diluted and gradient for sodium reabsorption is decreased. Remember that sodium reabsorption is gradient time dependent. So osmotic diuretics, site of action will be all along the nephron. What is mechanism of action? Mechanism of action of osmotic diuretics will be simply by eliminating water osmotically. What is the use? Osmotic diuretics can be used in cases of cerebral edema, particularly. Mannitol is the only drug, only osmotic diuretics which is important. So we did get introduced to diuretics under action, so I'm going to put a check mark there too. And this pretty much completes the presentation. Thank you for watching till the end. If you really like this presentation, give your like, comment, share this video and help others to learn this topic.